So here we are, Pentecost. It's the tail end of that much longer story of the disciples gathered in the upper room, that home base that they had established in Jerusalem. The place where they had gathered on that Maundy Thursday when Jesus had washed their feet, when they had celebrated the Passover meal together, remembering that ancient story of the transition from slavery to freedom through the power of God. It's the same room where they had been hiding out in those days after Jesus' crucifixion, afraid to leave lest they too be arrested and possibly crucified. It's the same room into which Jesus had walked when he showed them the holes in his hand and side, when Thomas, who had doubted, cried out, "My Lord and my God." The same room where they had been for 40 days until they went walking with Jesus, only to hear him tell them of events to come when he said that not long from now, you will be baptized by the Holy Spirit, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. And then they saw him taken up into the clouds. And when the angels asked them why they were standing around looking heavenward, they went back down the mountain to this same room. Now, I am certain, given the fact that human nature hardly changes, that once those disciples came from the mountain and huddled together once more in that upper room, they began looking at each other, saying, "You know, Jesus said, not long from now, the Spirit's going to come to us." And they looked at their watches. "It's been an hour." But nothing happened. And a day passed, and still they were there, not feeling anything, not hearing anything, not experiencing anything but what they'd already known. A week? A whole week passed, and there was still no sign of this promised Spirit. And I can imagine the disciples getting a little bit antsy. What are we waiting for? This isn't happening. Day 8. Day 9. And still no Spirit appearing. I can imagine Peter sitting there making his checklist for what he was going to need on the boat when he started fishing again. But then, on the 10th day, as the disciples were gathered, perhaps just beginning to call it off, perhaps just decided it was time to leave, that this was all a fantasy. Perhaps even asking the landlord to tally up the bill that they owed so that they could clear their debt and move on. That's what happened. It didn't start all at once. Perhaps just a puff of air moving in the room. But it didn't take long. That sound of a mighty rushing wind that came and moved among them. The small crackle of individual sparks coalescing into tongues of fire that came and rested upon each one. And then they knew what they'd been waiting for. Waiting's hard, isn't it? None of us are any good at it. At the hospital, I always tell people that time in the hospital is not like time on the outside. It doesn't move the same way. It drags. Waiting is like that. But those disciples who had put in their time waiting, watching, praying, wondering, hoping, finally felt that presence of the Spirit as it descended upon them. But it didn't just rest on them comfortably in one place. It propelled them out of the doors. It gave them words to speak. Each of the disciples, Galileans, people who spoke one language, and maybe not that one so very grammatically, were out there talking to the crowds in languages that they did not know, but that the people could hear. So much so that bystanders listening in thought that all these folks were drunk. After all, it was only 9 o'clock in the morning. But in telling the story, in speaking the languages of the crowd, the Spirit moved that day. And some 3,000 people, the book of Acts tells us, were added to the church. Now, today's reading from Acts is the single hardest reading in the entire 3-year lectionary cycle. By the way, Steve, you did a great job. The way you pronounced those names, and you just pushed right through, and you made us think that you knew how to say every single one.
Incorrect or not.
Incorrect or not, but you did it. Those are some hard words. Now, Persians, we can get our heads around those. Elamites maybe isn't so hard, but by the time we get to the residents of Pontus and Phrygia of Pamphylia, things get a little bit challenging. And when we tack on those Jewish proselytes and then string the whole thing together, it's the hardest reading that comes along. Most people get tongue-tied on it. For us, it is those unfamiliar polysyllabic sesquipedalian words themselves that cause problems. How often do you get to say sesquipedalian in a sermon? You've got to give me a break here. But for the folks of the day, on that first Pentecost, it wasn't the difficulty of the words themselves. It was what those words meant that was hard. Unlike us, the disciples and the people in the street, they knew what a Pamphylian was. They knew it all too well. Those Pamphylians, they were folks who couldn't be trusted. They were the people who moved with their families to Israel and never even bothered to learn how to speak Aramaic. They were the ones who would hang out among themselves speaking Pamphylian. Then there were the Cappadocians, swarming over the border and taking everyone's jobs. Well, at least some of the jobs. You know, the ones working in tanneries and that kind of thing. The ones that no Jew was willing to do because they violated the rules of keeping kosher. Yeah, those Cappadocians. You gotta look out for them. Then there were the Phrygians. They might have been heavily vetted, but you never know. One of them might be a terrorist. Those were hard words for people to hear. Perhaps harder words for the disciples to speak as they shared a gospel that welcomed these people in, that brought people to the gospel, that welcomed new community. And that's even without mentioning those Arabs or those Jewish proselytes who hadn't even been born into the faith. Those were some hard words. But the Holy Spirit not only empowered, but compelled the disciples to speak them and to welcome people into the family of the infant church. 10 days ago, on the day that Ascension Day fell, we cheated, we did Ascension Sunday, but on Ascension Day, the Hartford Courant ran an article about two of our sister churches here in Connecticut, First Congregational Church and South Congregational Church in Glastonbury. The article talked about the work that these churches, along with some 60 other UCC churches in Connecticut, are doing in resettling Syrian refugees. In our nation's political climate, you'd think that churches might be shying away from the work of helping people find new lives and safety and peace. But this article talked about the challenges and the joys, about the community that's built by bringing people together, to welcome people into a new land, to welcome the current round of immigrants in the same way that this nation welcomed our immigrant ancestors. Yes, on that first Pentecost, there were a lot of hard words. And I imagine that some of the hard words came from people saying, no, no, we don't want those Pamphylians. But still, the Spirit called the church into being, drawing us together from a disparate population, different people coming together in the power of the Spirit. In our reading from Paul's epistle this morning, we hear words of encouragement once more, talking about the body being made up of many parts. How we don't share the same gifts, how we come together as male and female, as Jew and Greek, as free and slave, how we are indeed drawn together. And you can be certain that had Paul been writing today, he probably would have included transgender and cisgender, gay, lesbian, bisexual, and straight. He would have given a list of people that he couldn't have begun to understand in his own day, but today draws us into community. Lots of hard words, words that people sometimes still can't get their heads around understanding how the community of Christ can be so radically diverse, so hugely hospitable. But we know that here, don't we? It's 4 years ago now that you became an open and affirming congregation, proudly declaring that we are a congregation that welcomes everyone, regardless of, and then gave the list. Good on you. I have to tell you that what I have found in my travels, and I've been in two or three churches over the course of the last 25 years. Over the course of my travels, it's the churches that not only say that they're welcoming, but embody it, as you do, that are the ones that are growing, that are the ones that find that a truly open door welcomes everyone in, but then sends us all out, just like those disciples so long ago on that first Pentecost, to tell the story of God's love in words that people can hear, speaking in each language, not just English and French and Spanish and Russian, but the languages of people's hearts. May we then find that the power of the Spirit that has come upon us this day and 4 years ago and years before that, as we have done work of refugee resettlement, may that same power propel us out to do the same work today as we share God's grace with the world. Amen.